Hello everyone, I hope you all are doing well by God's grace. Today I am back with the next short story, The Servant. This is by S.T. Semyonov and he is a Russian writer. He usually used to write regarding the peasantry class of Russia because he was born in a peasant family. So this is a touching story about Gerasim, who is a peasant lad, which means one who belongs to the working class. The story starts as such. Gerasim, he was moving about in vain in his village. He was working in Moscow, but then he was called back to his village for joining the military duty. Now, it is the case in certain countries or certain places where every young person, young man has to join the military. He was called for joining the military duty, but he could not get the job. He could not qualify. This left him with a problem. Why? Because in order to come to the village and join the military service, he had left his job in the city. And now he was in the village without any job, unemployed. And for a person who has spent most of his life in a city, it is very difficult to adjust in a village area because he or she might find it quite boring. So same was the case with Gerasim. He was not able to adjust in the village, so he decided to go back to Moscow. He came back to Moscow during a very bad time because it was the holiday season. No person would leave his or her job in the hope of getting a present. Like Diwali pe bonus milta hai, waise if you go abroad to other countries, there you get a bonus or some kind of a gift during Christmas or Thanksgiving. He had been working in Moscow ever since he was a very small child. When he was a very small kid, he used to go to a brewery. Brewery is a place where your beer is brewed, and he used to work as a bottle washer. Glass bottles jo wash karta, okay. So after that, when he grew up a little, as a young boy, he was working as the lower servant at someone's house. After that, he had joined as a servant in a merchant's house. He was summoned back to his village, called back to his village to join the military duty, and so he had to leave his job. Now when he came back to the merchant for getting his job back, obviously the place was filled. The merchant had appointed someone else. So now Gerasim was in Moscow, but he was without any job. He was unemployed and there was very low chance of him even getting some job or finding a job. He obviously didn't have a place to stay. So he was adjusting with the people of his own village. Whosoever was his known acquaintance was working in some place. His known people were also working as servants in someone's houses. So they were also facing a tough time because of Gerasim. He was being a burden on them. Why? Because obviously if you have a servant at your house, you will not appreciate it if they bring someone else to stay along with them, right? So Gerasim was feeling very bad when he was being a burden on his acquaintances. Many days he used to go without food because he had no money even to buy food or stay someplace. But he did not stop trying. He was finding it very hard to be without a job. He was a very hard-working boy. So from morning till night, he used to go around to search for a job. He did not leave any stone unturned, which means he tried his level best. He would even ask random people on the street if they knew of any vacancy in a job, but it was all in vain, which means it was of no use. He kept on looking for a job, but he did not get any job. But he was not happy that he, being a very strong boy, was not getting any work, and he didn't want to be without work. He was not a lazy guy, so he wanted to work and earn. He was trying his level best to find a job, any job, but because his timing was wrong and there was no vacancy anywhere because of the holiday season, so he was not knowing what to do. Finally, Gerasim decided to take himself to meet his friend. He was living on the outskirts of Moscow and he was a coachman by profession. Coachman means a person who drives this. And he was working under a wealthy merchant. And he was working with that merchant since many years. Now this coachman was a favorite of his master. The master used to hold him in high favor because he had a glib tongue. Glib tongue means maske lagata tha apne master ko, and he also used to talk about the other servants, baakiyon ki shikayate lagata tha. He was kind of a chamcha to his master. So he used to tell the master, he used to keep him updated about everyone, har kisi ke chugli lagata tha. So obviously the master valued such a person, usko pata tha ki this person ye kaam ka banda hai. So the master was very happy with this coachman. When Gerasim went to meet the coachman, obviously for a job, what happened? The coachman welcomed him quite well. He offered him proper tea and snacks and all. When he sat with the coachman obviously asked him, like what we ask generally when we meet the other person, how are you doing? To this, Gerasim responded saying that I'm not good at all. I'm doing very badly. Why? Because I've been without job for weeks and weeks now. It's been a long time. To this, the coachman asked, didn't you go back to your old master for the job which you left to go back to the village? And then Gerasim told him, yes, I did go there, but my place had already been filled by someone else. So the master did not take me back. So the coachman responded saying that, yeah, that is how you young people are. You don't work properly. And so your masters are not impressed with you. You should work in such a great way, in such a good way that your masters are quite impressed with you. And in case for any reason you have to leave the job, when you come back, the master should take you back without any second thoughts. In fact, he should throw out the other person who has been appointed in place of you. He was advising him that you should work so well so that the master only thinks about you. But the way you young people work nowadays, you are not dedicated towards your work. And so when you leave a job, you just spoil your chances of ever going back because the master can get another better option instead of you. So to this, Gerasim replied that, yeah, I know, but nowadays the masters are not like that. And we also are not exactly angels. It means that the servants are not very hardworking and even the masters are not very attached to their servants. It is not how it works nowadays. To this, the coachman gave him his own example saying that, take my example. If I have to leave my job for some reason and I come back, my master will take me back immediately and happily. He will be happy to get me back. He was obviously boasting about himself. Gerasim sat there downcast. Downcast means he was feeling very low and sad. And in a way, the coachman was insulting him. But now because he wanted his work, then he wanted the job somehow. So Gerasim thought, ki, theek hai. Okay, fine. Even if he's boasting, I cannot do anything about it. Let me gratify him so that at least he gets me some job or helps me out. Gratify means agle ko chane ke jhaad pe chadana, usko aur khush karna. So Gerasim also started talking well about the coachman that, yes, you to are such a good worker, or else you would not have been working with your master for 12 long years. People like you are very hard to find and all that. So the coachman, he was like puffed up with happiness and he was very happy to hear his own praise. Obviously uski tarif ho rahi thi, wo khush ho gaya, right? So he was like, ha, learn from me. If you also work like me, you will also be favored by your master and you will never lose a job. And to this, Gerasim made no reply because he didn't have any reply. Uski waste ho rahi thi, right? Then the coachman was summoned to his master, which means called by his master. And he told Gerasim that I'll just go and hear what the master has to say and come back. Just wait. And the coachman came back from the master. He informed Gerasim that he was supposed to go with the master to the town. So he had to harness the horses. Harness means ghodon ko coach ke aage, he was supposed to put them, place them, and wo sab lagam wagara he had to fit. Within half an hour, they had to leave for the town because the merchant had some work in the town. So after informing him about this, he was smoking a pipe. Now he took several turns in the room and he was in a very thoughtful mood, and then finally after taking a few rounds, he came and stood in front of Gerasim and he asked him, do you want a job? If you want, I can talk to my master. Now Gerasim, he obviously asked him, do you have a vacancy? So to this, the coachman replied that, yes, there is an old man who is working, but he is not a very good worker. He is of no use. It is a very good thing that this place is on the outskirts of the town, which means that the police does not come here very often, or else we could have gotten into some trouble. Why? Because the police keeps a check on the living conditions of your house, and if they think that your house is not in a good condition, then you can face some punishment. So the coachman said that the servant who works over here is not able to manage the house properly. If there were inspections by the police, then we would have gotten into trouble. So it is better that he is replaced, and so I can talk to my master to appoint you instead of the old useless worker. Now Jarasim obviously got happy. He thought that yes, I cannot miss this chance. So he told him, yes, please do try for me, do talk to your master and see if you can get me this job. And he said that I'll be thankful to you my entire life. Please, I pray that do this favor for me. I need a job very badly. Finally, the coachman took some money and gave it to Jarasim. He was obviously showing off. And then he told him that, okay, I'll talk to the master. You can come tomorrow and I will let you know. Once again before leaving, Jarasim was like, I request you kindly talk to the master for me. And the coachman was like, yeah, I'll talk, no problem. And then Jarasim took his leave. After Jarasim left, the coachman harnessed his horses and he wore his driver's uniform and he drove in front of the house. So the merchant, he sat in the sleigh and then they drove to the town. Whatever work he had, the merchant did that and came and sat back. He was a very smart man, this coachman. So he observed that his master was in a good mood. Now, even when we need a favor from someone, we like try to see if the other person is in a good mood or not. And if it is not the case, then we won't tell the other person. Hum favor mangenge hi nahi agar agla acche mood mein nahi hoga. So now coachman, when he saw that the master was in a good mood, so he started talking. He was like, Yegor Fyodorich, I have a favor to ask of you. And the merchant was like, yes, tell me. So the coachman told him that I have a young person from my village who has come here and he is in need of a job. So the merchant was like, okay, so what can I do? The coachman told him that you could keep him as a servant. But the merchant was like, I already have Polycarpage. Polycarpage is the name of the other old servant. Now the coachman started talking about Polycarpage. He started convincing the master that Polycarpage was of no use, and for that he tried his level best. He initiated by saying that Polycarpage is not a good servant, so it is about time that you should dismiss him. Usko naukri se nikal do. To this the merchant, his master, replied that no, he has worked with me for 15 long years. And it will be very wrong on my part to throw him out without any reason. To this, the coachman said that, okay, even if he had been working with you for years, he was not working for free. Usne koi ehsaan nahi ki, he has not done any favor for you. He was working for a salary and he has been paid for whatever work he has done through the years. And he might also have saved up from his job. Now, this person is telling his master that ek chote se naukar ne, from whatever he used to get, he must have saved up. Savings ki hogi. To this, the master replied, savings? What could he have saved? Because Polycarpage is not alone. He also has a wife to take care of. The coachman replied that, okay, yes, he has a wife, but she also works as a charwoman. She's also working, so both of them work and they must have saved quite a lot for their old age. They must have made savings for their old age. To this, the merchant said that, yeah, she must have saved a lot, right? Enough for both of them. This was a sarcastic comment. Polycarpet's wife was working as a charwoman, which means a cleaning lady. So I don't think that was a lot of money. Finally, the coachman understood that this merchant is not willing to throw Polycarpet out. So he thought that it is best that I start talking bad about Polycarpet. And next, what did he say? You should not care a lot about Polycarpage and his wife, because if I tell you honestly, he's a very poor worker. He is not a good worker. You are in a way throwing away your money on him. Matlab paise fenk rahe, which means you are wasting your money on keeping him as a servant. Then he started telling all sorts of lies about Polycarpage, that he never shovels the snow on time and he never keeps the house clean, and when it is his turn to be the watchman for the night, he slips away so many times. It is a good thing that we have not gotten into any trouble with the police or anyone till now, or else ही इज अ वेरी पुअर वर्कर, विच मीन्स ही डज नॉट वर्क वेल, काम से बचता है. एंड एक्चुअली वॉर्न्ड हिम दैट इफ द क्वार्टरली इंस्पेक्टर फाइंड्स आउट अबाउट हाउ पॉलीकार्पिच वर्क्स एंड हाउ ही मेंटेन्स अ हाउस विच इज नॉट अप टू द मार्क, ही विल कम एंड टॉक टू यू एंड दैट विल नॉट बी गुड फॉर यू. देन वाई? बिकॉज ऑब्वियसली वेन द पुलिस गेट्स इन्वॉल्व इट वोंट बी अ गुड थिंग. एंड सो ही गिव हिम अ वॉर्निंग दैट टेकिंग साइड ऑफ पॉलीकार्पिच विल पुट यू इन टू अ प्रॉब्लम. स्टिल द मर्चेंट वॉज नॉट विलिंग टू लेट गो ऑफ पॉलीकार्पिच. ही वॉज लाइक, नो, इट विल बी वेरी रफ फॉर हिम. He has been with me for 15 long years and now to just like throw him away during his old age, this will be a sin. The coachman said, a sin? Why would it be a sin? You make him work a lot. In fact, it will be quiet for him. It will be better for him. By now, the coachman understood that if I talk bad about Polycarpage, the merchant or the master will not get convinced. So he changed his tactic. Usne game plan hi change kar diya. Now instead of saying he's not a good worker, he said, if you throw Polycarpic out, it will be good for him only. Why? Because then he won't have to work so hard in his old age. He can easily go to almshouse. There they'll get everything and they won't have to work as well. So it will be better for them to rest and relax in their old age. When the merchant Sharov, he heard this, he now got a little convinced, because when he thought that, okay, if this is for the betterment of Polycarpic and his wife, then I can consider this. Finally, he said, okay, fine, bring your friend. I will see what I can do. So, which means that Sharov or the merchant was finally convinced to remove Polycarpic from his job. So, for the final touch, the coachman, he lied to the master. He said, yeah, do take Gerasim. He's a very good boy. He's such an exceptional worker. He was also working with someone else, but he had to go back to the village. If that wasn't the case, if he didn't have to go for the military duty, his old master would never have let him go, which was a lie. Next day, Gerasim was back at the coachman's place. And he was very anxious when he asked the coachman if he could do anything for him. So to this, the coachman didn't tell him straight away that he had talked to his master. He was like, yeah, I believe I've done, I could do something about it. So let us go to the master. But before that, let us have tea. Now, Gerasim was very eager for a decision. So he was not very interested in having tea. But he had to be polite because the coachman was offering him something. So he, in his anxiety, in his stress, he gulped down 2 cups of tea and then he ran to meet the merchant. The merchant asked him general questions about where he lived before and what work he did. And then this was all just a formality because the merchant had already made up his mind to appoint Gerasim. And finally, he told him, yes, okay, from tomorrow onwards, you can come and join your job as the man of all work, which means the caretaker of the entire house. Now, Gerasim was expecting a small job. He was shocked when he found out that he had landed such a good job. And he was stunned by the stroke of good fortune. Ki iski to kismat khul gayi thi, right? So, finally, they left from the master's place. He was so happy and so overwhelmed that he was not even able to walk properly. And finally, they came back to the coachman's room. And there, Gerasim thanked the coachman like anything, that thank you for getting me my job and all. And to this, coachman started telling him that, okay, yeah, I've got you the job, but please work properly, because you know, if the servant makes any error, then the master is after his or her life like anything. So don't give your master a chance. He was in a way again boasting about himself that do work like me so that the master will be mighty impressed with you. And don't let down my name because I have talked to the master to give you this job. So meri beizzati mat karwana, theek hai? So Gerasim was like, okay, no, don't worry. I will not let you down. And thank you so much. And with this, he took his leave. He left. Because the next day he was supposed to come back and join for work. He had to cross a yard before reaching to the gate. And while he was crossing the yard, he came across a room which he knew were the servant quarters, where from tomorrow onwards he was supposed to live. That is the place where the servants of the house would live. So he was so excited to see where he was going to stay. And he tried to peek in through the window of the room. Because it was very cold, the windows were all frosted and he could not see a thing. But he could listen to the voices coming from the room. He heard a woman's voice saying, "What will we do now?" It was obviously Polycarpet's wife. To this, the old man replied, "I don't know. Maybe go begging." Then the woman said that, "Okay, yeah, that is all we can do." They were servants, and now because of old age, when they were kicked out of their jobs, they could not find any other job, because obviously anyone would prefer a young person to work, right? So that only left them with one option of begging. And the old lady was feeling very sad, and she was almost crying and saying that, "We are such poor people. We work so hard and work for our masters for so many long years. We dedicate our entire lives for our masters, and in the end what happens? They just like throw us out as if we don't mean anything." And this made her refer to the master as a mean person. But then her husband, he told her that, "No, this is not the fault of a master. The coachman has convinced him and he has poisoned his ears against us. He has told him that we are not good workers." To this, the old lady called the coachman a serpent. Serpent means a snake. And she was like, "He knows how to wag his tongue. Isko apna zuban chalani aati hai. He has convinced the master about us not being good enough for the job." But then she was like, "I will also take revenge. I will also tell to the master that he is a thief. Like, I'll tell the master how he steals hay and fodder." Means coachman, he took care of the horses, and she says that he used to steal from the master's fodder, which is kept for the horses. Polycarpus told his wife not to sin. He was like, "No, although the coachman has done wrong, but we will not reciprocate. We will not do wrong in return." His wife replied that, "Sin? How will I sin? I will only tell the master the truth about the coachman. The master also needs to know that how the coachman is not a good worker and how he is deceiving him. Wo dhoka de raha hai apne master ko. And aise bhi, what else can we do about it now? The coachman, he has ruined us. Now we don't have anywhere to go. He has ruined our lives." And with this, she started crying loudly. When Gerasim heard all this, he overheard all this, it stabbed him like a dagger in his heart. In the sense that usko aisa laga kisi ne usko khanjar maar diya. It was so painful for him to know that because of him, the poor old couple was put in such a bad condition. And he was very sad and very shocked to know that he was the reason for bringing such misfortune on the old couple, and because of him, this poor old couple was crying. They were ruined without any fault of their own. It made him sick at heart. He was not feeling good at all about himself. He stood there for a long time. He was very saddened and he was lost in thought. He kept on thinking that, "How can I make this right?" And finally he made up his mind and he went back to the coachman's room. When he came back, the coachman asked him, "Why you're back? Did you forget anything?" And so Gerasim, he stammered and said, "No, I've come, listen to me. I'm very thankful about the pains you took to get me the job, but it's just that I cannot keep the job." Coachman was shocked. He was like, what do you mean? Gerasim didn't want to explain to him that, "I know about how you got me this job. And I've overheard Polycarpus and his wife's conversation." So all he had no justification. He could only say nothing. "No, there's no reason. But I just cannot take the job." Now, obviously, the coachman, he flew in rage. He got very angry and he showed his true colors to Gerasim. He started abusing him. "You rascal, you have disgraced me. You come here and request me for a job. And when I work hard to get you a job, you refuse. You have disgraced me. Meri beizzati kara di hai." Then he started abusing Gerasim. He just looked down and he reddened in his face because of embarrassment. The coachman, he was very angry, and after abusing Gerasim, he just turned his back very angrily and just he went quiet. Gerasim took this chance. He very quietly and quickly left the room, and then he crossed the yard again, once again. But this time when he crossed the yard and went out to the street, he was feeling very light-hearted. Because although he didn't have a job, but he had this satisfaction that he had not hurt anyone else for his selfish reasons. Sometimes doing the right thing might earn you abuse, but still you will feel lighthearted and at peace with yourself, and that is what matters. So this is about Gerasim, and this shows his humility. This is important question from your examination point of view. He had humility, that is why he listened to his conscience, which told him it was wrong to bring misfortune on someone else for his own selfish reasons. He was kind-hearted and he had sympathy for others, and when he came to know that because of him someone else was going to face difficulties, he chose to continue living a difficult life himself instead of putting anyone else in problem. Sometimes people just think about the end result. They don't care about what wrong things they have to do to attain that end result. But that is not the way it should be. You should always have humility and consideration about the other people as well. And the story also shows us the contrast between the coachman and Gerasim. This is also a very important question. While they were from the same village, they were friends, they were acquaintances, but they were poles apart. The coachman is obviously a negative character. He is kind of the villain of the story, although he was a good friend and he wanted to help his friend, but that too was for the wrong reasons. He just wanted to show off in front of Gerasim. Gerasim, on the other hand, he's a very good person. He did not let his conditions rule over his mind, although he was unemployed, but he did not let that make him choose the wrong way. So he was a man of heart. The coachman is shown as a quite selfish person, and Gerasim is self-sacrificing. So there are many other such points about the difference between these two people. I hope that this chapter was clear to you, and in case if you have any doubt or any query, do let me know. God bless you. Love your parents. Stay home and stay safe.